Penguin Random House Audio presents Thursday's Children by Nicci French. Read for you by Beth Chalmers.
Chapter 1. It started with a reunion, and it ended with a reunion, and Frieda Klein hated reunions. She was sitting in front of her fire, listening to its slow crackle. Beside her was Sasha, who was staring into the glow. Beside Sasha was a buggy. In the buggy was Sasha's 10-month-old son, Ethan, a blur of dark hair and soft snoring. A cat lay at Frieda's feet, faintly purring. They could hear the wind blowing outside. It had been a day of fog and swirling leaves and gusts of wind. Now it was dark, and they were inside, hiding from the approaching winter. "I've got to admit," said Sasha, "that I'm intrigued by the idea of meeting an old school friend of yours." "She wasn't a friend, she was in my class." "What does she want?" "I don't know. She rang me up and said she needed to see me. She said it was important and that she'd be here at 7. "What time is it now?" Frieda looked at her watch. "Almost 7. "I don't know things like that anymore. Since Ethan was born, I've forgotten what a night's sleep is like and my brain has turned into sludge. I don't even know what day it is. Is it Wednesday?"
"Thursday."
"That's good. Almost the weekend." Frieda gazed back into the fire. "Thursday's perhaps the worst day of the week. It's nothing in itself. It just reminds you that the week's been going on too long." Sasha pulled a face. "That may be reading too much into it." She leaned over the buggy and stroked her son's hair. "I love him so much, but sometimes when he's asleep, I feel relieved and grateful. Is that a terrible thing to say?" Frieda turned to her friend. "Is Frank helping out?" "He does his best, but he's so busy with his work. As he says, helping the guilty walk free."
"That's his job," said Frieda. "He's a defense barrister, and..."
She was interrupted by a ring at the door. Frieda gave Sasha a rueful look. "You are going to answer it, aren't you?" Sasha said.
I was tempted to hide.
Opening the door, she heard a voice that seemed to come out of the darkness and was immediately enfolded in a hug. "Frieda Klein," said the woman. "I'd know you anywhere. You look just like your mother."
"I didn't know you'd ever met my mother."
She gestured towards the fireplace. "This is my friend, Sasha. This is Madeline Bucknell."
"Maddie," said the woman.
"Maddie Capel. I got married."
Maddie Capel put down her large embossed bag and unwound a checkered scarf from her neck. She took off a heavy brown coat that she handed to Frieda. Underneath, she was wearing a maroon crossover dress with wedge-heeled leather boots. There was a thick gold chain round her neck and small gold earrings in her lobes. She smelled of expensive perfume. She stepped towards the fire and looked into the buggy.
"What a darling little thing," she said. "Frieda, is it yours?"
Frieda pointed at Sasha.
"Just the sight of it makes me want to have another," said Maddie. "I love them at that age, when they're like a warm bundle. Is it a boy or a girl?"
"A boy."
"So cute. Is he walking yet?"
"He's only 10 months old."
"You just need to be patient."
Frieda pulled a chair up close to the fire, and Maddie sat down. She had long brown hair, artfully styled into shagginess and streaked with blonde. Her face was carefully made up, but this only emphasized the tightness of the skin over the cheekbones, the little lines around the eyes and at the corners of the mouth. Frieda remembered her from school. Cheerful, laughing, loud, but there was always an anxiety. Being in the group or not in the group. Having a boyfriend or not having a boyfriend.
"Should I give you some privacy?" said Sasha.
"No, no, it's lovely to meet a friend of Frieda's. Do you live here as well?" Sasha gave a faint smile.
"No, I live with my partner. Somewhere else."
"Yes, of course. Thank you, thank you," she said as Frieda handed her a mug of tea. She took a sip and looked around her.
"Such a sweet little place you have here. Cozy."
Another sip. I read about you in the newspaper, Frieda. About how you helped on that terrible, terrible case with all those girls, and you rescued one of them.
Only one, said Frieda. And it wasn't just me.
How can people do things like that?
There was a pause. What was it you wanted to talk to me about? A gulp of tea.
I can't believe we've lost touch, Maddie said. You know that I still live in Braxton. Do you ever come back?
No.
Some of the old lot are still there. She gave a mischievous smile. I remember you and Jeremy. I used to be rather jealous of you. He was quite a catch. He left, of course. Do you keep in touch with him?
No.
I married Stephen. Stephen Capel. Did you know him?
We had some good years, but it went wrong. He's remarried, but he still lives nearby.
When you phoned, you said there was something you needed to talk to me about.
Another gulp of tea. Maddie looked around.
Is there somewhere I can put this?
Frieda took the mug from her.
I've read about you in the paper.
You said?
More than once, Maddie said. You've attracted quite a lot of attention.
Not by choice.
Yes, it must be difficult sometimes. But they said that apart from solving crimes...
That's not really... Frieda began, and Sasha smiled again.
No, but the articles mentioned that you're a psychologist.
I'm a psychotherapist.
I'm not very good on all the jargon, said Maddie. I'm sure there's a difference. I don't know all the details, but from what I understand, people talk to you and you help them. Is that right?
Frieda leaned forward. What is it you want?
It's not me. Maddie gave a little laugh. If that's what you're thinking, not that I couldn't do with some help. When Stephen left, I was crying for days and days. Weeks, really. I didn't know who to turn to.
There was another pause.
I know things like that are terrible, said Frieda. But please, why have you come to see me? It'll sound silly. It's probably a waste of your time, my coming up all the way from the country.
Should I leave? Asked Sasha again.
No, said Maddie. We're just old friends talking.
Tell me what you want from me.
Maddie hesitated. Frieda had experienced this moment dozens of times with her patients.
One of the most difficult, precarious moments in therapy was that first naming of the patient's fear. It was like jumping off a cliff edge into darkness.
It's my daughter, Becky, said Maddie. Rebecca, but everyone calls her Becky. She's 15, almost 16.
Has something happened?
No, no, nothing like that. It's hard to put into words. Becky was such a sweet little girl. When I looked at this little boy in the buggy, it reminded me of those days when it was all so simple. I could just look after her. You know, when Becky was that age, I thought I was going to have lots of children, and I was going to be the best mother in the world and protect them from everything. I was so young when I had her, almost a child myself, and then...
She breathed deeply, as if she were trying to control herself.
I couldn't have another child. And then Stephen left. It was probably my fault. I tried to hide the way I felt from Becky, but I didn't do a very good job. She was only six, little thing, and I was still in my 20s and all over the place.
Her voice wavered and she stopped for a moment.
It must have hit her hard, but I thought we'd come through it.
I suppose I'd always dreaded the teenage years. She glanced at Frieda. Maybe I was thinking of our own teenage years. We got up to one or two things that we probably regret now, didn't we? A voice inside Frieda was saying, "What do you mean, we?" We weren't friends. We didn't get up to anything together. But she stayed silent and waited.
In the last year or so, she's changed. I know what you're going to say. She's just an adolescent. What am I worrying about? Well, I am worrying. To begin with, she was just withdrawn and moody, and she wouldn't talk about anything. I wondered whether there were drugs or boys involved, or drugs and boys. I tried to ask her about it. I tried to be sympathetic. Nothing worked. About a month ago, it got worse. She seemed different. She looked different. She stopped eating.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.